curve up towards the center. Philadelphia, you'll see them, they're just straight across. Bashir, Bella, that Steve was just talking about, did his down this way. Everybody wanted to do things a little differently so that they put their own little signature on the piece. The way we do that is we have a block here, which is just, you know, a block with a V cut in it. I think it's 2 inches wide, roughly this way. So we cut a board. It has, really, I just cut a straight board and then notched it so that it'll fit around here. I've set the cradles on there. The shoulder here, right there, rests on the edge of this board here. You see the edge here. And, so that on your holder here. And then you set it in here. Do the center one first. And then you can move it, you can pick it up and take it out and move it over to the other line that I have next to it. And then, and this takes a little bit of practice. You're gonna try it on a spare seat. And then you can just scrape it back and forth. Now,
moving on, starting out three with chair making is the importance of grain orientation in your work. I don't think it's any less important than any other kind of furniture making, but the joints in chairs overall get a lot more stress, especially for their dimension, than a case goods get stressed. So everything from the precision, the moisture content, the grain orientation, and how well you glue the joint is a lot more important in a chair, because I really need to get the full strength of that wood in every joint, because I don't want to have a heavy chair. I don't want to have an excessive number of parts just because I can't get that. If I can get joints that are as strong as possible, I need a lot fewer of them, and I can make a stronger, lighter chair. So part of that has to do with the way that I take the wood from the log. And starting out, buying logs and splitting them out sort of spoiled me in terms of having full freedom to manipulate that material any way I wanted to. I wasn't limited to 8-quarter stock, 4-quarter stock, or whatever they had at the lumber store. I can take that log and make whatever size pieces however I want. And then even going to the sawmill, I can still have them cut it however I want. Also in whatever grain orientation I want. And that does a lot to free me up in my design work, not just in the way I think about the way the piece is going to look, but structurally, how the piece is going to hold up.
To really understand the arts and crafts movement, we need to look to England. And in the period, England was still ahead of us for fashion, for style, for sophisticated things in society. They were also about 50 years ahead in the start of the arts and crafts movement. Around 1850, mainly the two voices of the English movement were William Morris and John Huston. And what they said is, you know, we're producing this stuff in factories. It isn't very good, so the people who are the end customers aren't being well served. And the people who are making it are really being overworked and abused and generally miserable. So even though machinery has given us this technology to do things, we're not using it right, and there should be a better way to do it. Their solution was to kind of look back and idealize the past, and I think that's a pretty common thing that people do and a pretty easy thing to do. You know, they kind of look back and said we should scrap the whole machine thing, go back to the days of guilds and craftsmen, and that's how things should be. In England and a lot of the arts and crafts movement in the United States, it was as much a social movement as it was an artistic movement.
How wide should it be? Well, why don't we go ahead and try two of those eights? Just for fun, let's see what that looks like. What do we think? It sure fills the whole space. Of course, the star will be inside of that, but I'm willing to go with that. That was really simple. I just had that proportion right on hand, so just go ahead and use it. You can always shrink it up if you want. But the question was, how do we lay out the star really quickly? Well, one way I do it. This is the radius that we just gave, correct? Just go ahead and start at the top. Well, if I were to walk this around, what you get because of the wonders of geometry, you get a hexagon, which is six-sided. We want five-sided. So basically what that tells me, this needs to be a little bit bigger. This covers more space, correct? So all I'm going to do is open it up a little bit. And it's just a guess, but it just takes me a second to walk around. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Hi, I'm Dan Barrett. I'm with D.L. Barrett & Sons, and with me is my son, Kyle. We produce reproduction wood-bodied planes, everything from bench planes to molding planes, including plow planes.
Okay, Gary, so we're standing in front of your full line of hand planes, and you've got everything from smoothers to jointers. And it looks like you even have block planes now also.
Yeah, these are a new addition. Just came out with these. It's a little wooden block plane.
Okay.
One of the only wooden block planes on the market.
Right. I was going to say, that's pretty unique. I don't think I've ever seen one before.
I think there's the ECE makes a little wooden block plane, mm-hmm. but that's probably about it.
Okay. All right, folks. So I am here with Bob, and he is Check Edge Tools.
And Check Edge hand tool.
Yeah, that's the one.
That's the one.
Either way, they're amazing tools. Now, you have a whole line here of marking knives.
Right.
And in fact, it's three different sizes. It's two different sizes. Or three
Actually,
different
three
sizes.
Actually, three different sizes.
Okay.
We have our smallest size, the Curve Cadet, which has a about 29 thousandths thick blade, which is a little over about 5/16 wide and about 1.25 inches long.